Penguin Random House Canada presents Eating Dirt, Deep Forests, Big Timber, and Life with the Tree Planting Tribe by Charlotte Gill. Read for you by Asha Vijayasingham. For the People of the Tribe. I made a shift to go forward till I came to a part of the field where the corn had been laid by the rain and wind. Here it was impossible for me to advance a step, for the stalks were so interwoven that I could not creep through, and the beards of the fallen ears so strong and pointed that they pierced through my clothes into my flesh. At the same time, I heard the reapers not 100 yards behind me. Jonathan Swift, Gulliver's Travels, A Voyage to Brobdingnag. He was a work beast. He had no mental life whatever, yet deep down in the crypts of his mind, unknown to him, were being weighed and sifted every hour of his toil, every movement of his hands, every twitch of his muscles, and preparations were making for a future course of action that would amaze him and all his little world. Jack London, The Apostate. 1. The Last Place on Earth. We fall out of bed and into our rags, still crusted with the grime of yesterday. We're earth-stained on our thighs and shoulders, and muddy bands circle our waists, like grunge rings on the sides of a bathtub. Permadirt, we call it. Disposable clothes, too dirty for the laundry. The sun comes up with the strength of a dingy light bulb, dousing the landscape in shades of gray. The clouds are bruised and swollen. We stand in a gravel lot, a clearing hacked from the forest. Heavy logging machinery sits dormant all around, skidders and yarders like hulking metallic crabs. The weather sets in as it always does, as soon as we venture outdoors. Our raincoats are glossy with it. The air hisses. Already, we feel the drips down the backs of our necks, the dribbles down the thighs of our pants. We're professional tree planters. It's February, and our wheels have barely begun to grind. We stand around in huddles of 3 and 4, with toothpaste at the corners of our mouths, sleep still encrusted in our eyes. We stuff our hands down into our pockets and shrug our shoulders up around our ears. We wear polypropylene and fleece and old pants that flap apart at the seams. We sport the grown-out remains of our last haircuts and a rampant facial shagginess, since mostly we are men. We crack dark, miserable jokes. Oh, run me over. Go get the truck. I'll just lie down here in this puddle. If I run over your legs, who will run over mine? We shuffle from foot to foot, feeding on breakfast buns wrapped in aluminum foil. We drink coffee from old spaghetti sauce jars. We exhale steam. Around here, you can hang a towel over a clothesline in November, and it will drip until April. Adam and Brian are our sergeants. They are exactly the same height and wear matching utility vests made of red canvas. Heads bent together, they embroil themselves in what they call a meeting of the minds, turning topographical maps this way and that, testing the handheld radios to ascertain which ones have run out of juice. Their lips barely move when they talk. Their shoulders collect the rain. We wait for their plan of attack, as if it is an actual attack, a kind of green guerrilla warfare. At the stroke of 7, we climb up into big Ford pickup trucks with mud-chewing tires and long radio antennae. We slide across the bench seats, shoving ourselves in together. 5 diesel engines roar to life. Adam sits at the wheel. He has an angular face, hair and skin turned tawny by the outdoor life, arresting eyes the color of mint mouthwash. He pulls out at the head of our small convoy. His pupils zip back and forth over the road's unpaved surface. He drives like a man on a suicide mission. No one complains. Speed is the jet fuel that runs our business. While he drives, Adam wraps his lips around the unwashed lid of a commuter mug. He slides aluminum clipboards in and out of his bag and calls out our kilometers on the truck-to-truck radio. Logging trucks barrel down these roads, laden with bounty like land-borne supertankers. Adam slides his maps into various forms of plastic weatherproofing. Multitasking is his only speed, as it is for all of us. Too fast, too much, and all at once. We're peace workers, here to make money, a lot of it, in a hurry. Earning our keep can feel like picking quarters off a sidewalk, and it can feel like an emergency. Logging routes are like human arteries, main lines branching out into fine traceries. We pass from civilization to wilderness on a road with muddy ruts. Old snow decomposes along the shoulder. The land around here is jaggedly three-dimensional, fissured with gullies and brush-choked ravines. Mountains bulge from the seashore. We zoom through stands of tall Douglas firs, conifers bearded with lichen, a green blaze. We're driving so fast, skimming along the surface of our known world. Most of us are veterans. Crusty, we call each other. Like those special ops who crawl from war-ravaged mountains with wild hair, matted beards, and battle-mad glints in their eyes. Sean and Pierre were doing this job, they sometimes remind us, when the rest of us were in diapers. Pierre is 55. He tells us he has a resting pulse rate lower than Lance Armstrong's. He tells us 100 things, every day, in great detail. He shows us the display screen of his digital camera. He shows us photos of ravens and skunk cabbage, snapshots from his civilian life, his faraway kids, his foxy lady friends. Sean is both wiry and muscular. He has a titanium hip. Some of his clothes are as old as his tree planting career, threadbare, unraveling around the edges. He plants trees for half the year and windsurfs the remaining portions. His lips and cheeks are speckled with liver spots from a life in the sun. But like Pierre, he's still going. Jake, at 21, is the youngest. Jake calls Pierre old man. He refers to himself as Elfie in the third person. Elfie's not digging this action, he says. Elfie thinks this is fucked up. Oakley and Jake are best pals. Jake is short and muscular. He talks in rowdy shouts. Oakley is tall and sturdy. We always know where he's working, because his lunchbox is a plastic tub that once contained a bodybuilding supplement. Find the mega milk on the side of the road, and you know Oakley's beavering away behind the rise. Oakley and Jake play hacky sack for hours every evening, and Pierre documents this too with his digicam. We spend a lot of time in trucks, and it's here we get to know one another. The crew cabs are our living rooms. The bench seats are sofas. Nick is redheaded. He reminds us of Richie Cunningham. He doesn't drink. He says he used to. Some call him risky, like the business. Carmen knits. She's a single mom. Her boys are at home with her parents. On commutes, she clicks away with her needles at socks the size of kiwi fruits. Sean has more seniority than anyone, and he has an inexhaustible supply of jokes to prove it. How many tree planters does it take to screw in a light bulb? One, but you'll find 5 bulbs in the socket. What do you call a tree planter without a girlfriend? Homeless. No one is offended. We're unisex guys, the men of man days. The work wears us down and lifts us up. Everyone together, equally. Sometimes we glance sideways at the old timers, and we wonder just how long we'll keep doing this job. We think, take me out before I end up old and battered and stooped like Quasimodo. But we're halfway there already. It feels as if we've been doing this job for 1,000 years and our bodies are rusted with it. I nestle among my work comrades, as I have done for nearly 20 years. The rituals and routines of planting trees are as familiar to me as boiling water or brushing my teeth. But February always shocks me. Usually, I'm unfit after a lazy indoor winter. So is KT. He's my boyfriend and also my coworker. We've made a life of it. City dwellers in the winter, tree planters come spring. Now, after 1 week on the job, even my eyelids feel sore. My palms and heels are blistered. I still yearn for the comforts of home, the ease of the easy chair, the depths of my own downy bed. Soon enough, these cravings will evaporate. In 8 hours, I'll be too tired to care. To say planting trees is my day job is not quite right, because to do such work is to give one's whole life, albeit temporarily. There's no room for taking notes. When I plant trees, both hands are entirely spoken for. When Adam hurdles us around the bends, we slide into one another. Our toes bump against a heavy-duty jack, coffee mugs with broken handles, a soggy wool sock, and empty sandwich bags.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.